come back with your next class. In today's class, we are going to discuss a new chapter, that is environmental issues. This chapter is the last one in the section of ecology. And in this chapter, mainly, we are going to discuss the different forms of pollution and what are the ways how we can combat such kind of problems. All right. So, see, in the last 100 years, human population has grown tremendously. Because of human population growing at such rapid rate, of course there is a great demand for home or electricity or any kind of necessity for our basic necessities for our survival. They are also getting increased. The demand for that is also getting increased, isn't it? And of course then this demand is putting a tremendous pressure on our natural resources, right? And that's why we are having to overexploit them and hence leading to pollution. All right. So this is the basic, the basic root cause of all form of pollution is because of rapid growth of human population. Otherwise, this problem would not have been encountered. All right. So this chapter is all about learning about what is pollution and what are the different forms. So let's see what it is all about. Let's see the introduction. All right. See. Pollution is any undesirable change in physical, chemical or biological characteristics of air, land, water or soil. Agents that brings about these changes are called pollutants. All right. Now, in order to control the pollution or control it, Government of India has passed Environmental Protection Act 1986 to protect and improve the quality of air, water and soil. All right. Now, other than that, other significant changes are brought about in the lower atmosphere as well. That is also a matter of concern due to the increase in concentration of carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases and depletion of stratospheric ozone layer. So this is another set of problems that we are facing in today's world. All right. So now, thus in this chapter, we'll be studying the causes, effects and control of pollution, the implication of global environmental changes due to increasing concentration of greenhouse gases and the depletion of ozone in stratosphere and its possible effects. So this is what is the introduction all about. So let's finally start with air pollution. Now let us start with air pollution. All right. So see, it is the occurrence of any material or gas in the air in such a concentration which is harmful to man, vegetation, animal and their environment. All right. Now, it can be both natural and anthropogenic in nature. Anthropogenic means man-made. Okay. So naturally also air can get polluted, like in case of forest fires or volcanic eruptions, etc. Or rather, you would be surprised to know that maximum percentage of air pollution, to be specific, 99.95% of air pollution is caused by natural reasons. Okay, it is caused due to natural reasons, whereas only hardly 1% of air pollution will be caused due to man-made activities, anthropogenic activities. All right. Now, anthropogenic pollution comes from both fixed and mobile sources. Like industries will be a fixed source, whereas mobile sources will be the automobiles. All right. Now, air pollutants coming directly from pollution sources are called primary air pollutants, like carbon monoxide, sulfur dioxide, etc. Whereas reaction between two or more primary pollutants gives rise to secondary air pollutants, like ozone or PAN. All right. Now, causes of air pollution. Now, all of you know what can be the causes of air pollution, like smokestacks of thermal power plants, smelters and other industries release particulate and gaseous air pollutants. Pollutants from automobiles, locomotives, aircrafts and exhaust in cities constitutes major air pollution. Incomplete and complete combustion of carbon contents of fossil fuel, wood and charcoal forms carbon monoxide and carbon dioxide, and that would further also lead to formation of sulfur dioxide. Natural sources like pollen, dust and smoke. Smoke arising from forest fire, that would be a natural source, isn't it? These are the reasons why air pollution would be caused. All right. Now finally, what would be the consequence of air pollution? Now, of course, air pollution would be maximum, you know, it will be mostly affecting the respiratory system of animals and human. Also, it would be causing premature death of plants, right? Like air pollution causes injury to all living organisms, of course, and they reduce growth and yield of crops and premature death of plants. It deleteriously affects respiratory system of human and animals. Harmful effects depends on concentration of pollutants, duration of exposure, and of course the organism. So how air pollution is going to be affecting an organism will depend on these 3 points. Concentration of the pollutant, how much duration the exposure was done, and of course the organism, what kind of organism it is, whether it's an animal, it's a plant, or in case of human. Alright, so accordingly the result will keep varying from one organism to another. Alright, now let us discuss the types of air pollutants. Okay, so as you can see, there are mainly 2 types of air pollutants, gaseous material and particulate matter. So let us discuss them in details. First, gaseous material. The major air pollutant among this category would be carbon monoxide. Now, carbon monoxide is produced by incomplete combustion of fossil fuel. And once it is produced and inhaled, it will be producing carboxyhemoglobin, which reduces the oxygen carrying capacity of blood, which instead will be causing dizziness, nausea, headache, etc. Alright. Next is sulfur dioxide. It is produced in oil refineries, smelters of ores, combustion of sulfur containing fuels. Now, once it is produced, what kind of results or effects it would have? It inhibits ETC in case of plants. It will result in acid rains, eye irritation, severe respiratory problems. Next is nitrogen oxides. Now, it would be produced by combustion of fossil fuel at high temperature in automobile engines. Okay, and it would be maximum resulting into heart and lungs problems. Alright. And the last is hydrocarbons. Hydrocarbons would be produced by incomplete combustion as unburned discharge, and it would mostly be resulting in cancers. Okay. So now, this being the different types of gaseous materials, now let's see what are the particulate matters. Okay. See, particulate matter, these are released by industries, automobiles, etc., and may be liquid or solid. And finally, we can categorize them into 2 types according to their size or diameter. Alright. So first is suspended. Suspended one is going to be more harmful because it's much smaller. It has a diameter of less than 10 micrometer and remains in the air for weeks. It doesn't settle down. Alright. Whereas settleable has a diameter of more than 10 micrometer. Hence, it settles in less than 1 day, and that's why it will cause much lesser harm. Alright. Now, if we have to learn about a few important examples under particulate matter, these are as follows. First is aerosols. These are vapor chemicals in the form of fluorocarbons or chlorofluorocarbons, etc. These are emitted by, jet and supersonic aeroplanes, then refrigerators, ACs, etc. and would be maximum or mostly resulting into ozone depletion. Alright. Next, smoke. That is visible suspension of carbon. It would be basically the source of smoke, can be burning and smoldering of organic matter, fly ashes from power stations, etc. And it would cause asthma and bronchitis, that is the severe respiratory ailments, and decreases visibility. Of course, smoke will be reducing visibility. Next, dust and mist. These are of course released from the industries and would be causing different kind of diseases in human. Like in asbestos industry, it will cause asbestosis. Then in case of stone grinders, it will cause silicosis. Then for iron mills, it will cause siderosis, etc. So these are all occupational hazards. Finally, spores and bacteria. So the source is of course air, and this would cause allergic reactions like hay fever in human. Alright, so this being important examples. Now, according to CPCB, that is Central Pollution Control Board, particulate of size 2.5 micrometer or less is responsible for causing maximum harm to human health. Alright, so do remember the size, and 2.5 micrometer is mostly hazardous for human health. Alright, so this being said, next let us see how we can control air pollution. Now let us see how to control air pollution. Alright, so see, there are various methods how you can effectively reduce air pollution. First would be electrostatic precipitator, which is a very effective means. So basically it's a mean, or it's a device by which we can separate the dust particles from the air. Whatever dust particles are present in the air, that can be separated by the usage of electrostatic precipitator. See here, it is most effective device to remove over 99% of particulate matter present in the exhaust from a thermal power plant. So it is mostly installed in a thermal power plant. Now, it has electrode wires that are maintained at several thousand volts, which produces a corona that releases electrons. Alright, so it is going to release electrons at a very high volt. So these electrons attach to the dust particles, giving them a net negative charge. So while the air is going to pass through the plates, the electrons are going to provide a net negative charge to all the dust particles which are suspended in the air. The collecting plates are grounded and attract the charged dust particles. So the plates which are going to be maintained at a positive charge, they are now going to attract all the dust particles. Hence, the air that will be finally coming out from the other end will be free from dust particles. But yes, through electrostatic precipitator, for this whole reaction to occur, the air has to be passed on very slowly. Otherwise, this net negative charging or separation would not take place. Alright, so see here, the velocity of the air between the plates must be low enough to allow the dust to fall. Alright, now next is scrubber. Now scrubber is going to be installed in those industries where sulfur dioxide is going to be produced as a byproduct. Alright, so see here, the industries which produces sulfur dioxide as a byproduct uses scrubber. In this method, the effluent containing sulfur dioxide are passed through a slurry of water and crushed limestone, that is CaCO3. The calcium in limestone combines chemically with sulfur to produce calcium sulfate, which is separately collected. Alright, it's a simple reaction. So it's a simple chemical reaction by which sulfur can be separated from the air before it is released from the exhaust. Alright, now next. Control of automobile exhaust. See, proper maintenance of the automobiles along with use of lead-free petrol or diesel can reduce pollutants from the automobile exhaust. Likewise, catalytic converters, these are very important. Catalytic converters have costly metals like platinum, palladium and rhodium etc. as catalysts. So what exactly happens here, you see, exhaust gases first passes through the catalytic converter, thereby the hydrocarbons which remains or which are left unburned are oxidized to carbon dioxide and water. Carbon monoxide is also oxidized to carbon dioxide. So something that is more harmful in nature will be converted to something less harmful due to the effect of catalytic converters in the automobile exhaust. All right. Finally, very, very important point, the Air Act 1981, the Air Prevention and Control of Pollution Act 1981, this act deals with preservation of air quality and control of air pollution. Not only that, in 1987, important amendment was made to this act. Accordingly, noise was recognized as air pollutant. So in 1987, noise was also taken to be a part of air pollutant itself. So next, let us discuss about noise pollution. Now let us discuss noise pollution. Alright. So see, noise pollution is any unwanted sound that is dumped into the atmosphere to disturb unwilling ears. It is measured by a sound meter and expressed in a unit called decibel. Any value more than 80 decibel causes noise pollution, and it is unbearable at 140 decibel. Alright. Now,
sources of noise pollution. It can be natural or man-made sources. You might be thinking naturally thundering can cause a lot of noise pollution, isn't it? But then we are mostly concerned with man-made noise pollution. So see, the main sources of man-made noise pollution are sounds from industries, of course, defense materials like rockets, tanks, etc. Entertainment sources like record players, radio, loudspeakers, etc. And transport automobiles. Okay. Finally, what are the effects? Of course, you can yourself guess what can be the effect. Like, if the noise is at a very high decibel, say above 150 decibel, in that case, it can cause permanent damage to the eardrums. Likewise, it can also cause sleeplessness, increased heartbeat, stress to human beings. Alright? Finally, what are the methods to reduce noise pollution? See, first, use of sound absorbent materials. Permissible sound limits of crackers or loudspeakers, etc. I should say that crackers should be completely banned, isn't it? Permissible sound limits for crackers is something that doesn't make sense. Horn-free zones near hospitals, schools, etc. Planting trees under green muffler scheme. Now, green muffler scheme, under these schemes, wherever there are industries, the boundary to that should be planted with trees like Ashoka, Neem, etc. Because these trees, they are very good in absorbing noise, okay, or absorbing sound. That's what is called green muffler scheme. Alright, that is planting trees like Ashoka, Neem, etc. nearby to the industries. And the last one is use of earplugs or earmuffs. Alright, so that's all regarding air pollution. In the next class, we'll start with case study of air pollution. Thank you.